want to invite you to come from the back room and come into the Holy of Holies up front here and join us as we lift up the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and declare our victory in Him. Amen. We sing through the midst.
Through the midst of darkness, we're reassured by your love. We lean on Christ our Savior, the risen King victorious. Through the midst of darkness, we're reassured by your love. We lean on Christ our Savior, the risen King victorious.
Is defeated, we rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke us is no more, cause you're alive.
You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our life. Unlock my strong tower, dominion is mine. You are victorious. Victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our life. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mind. You are victorious.
See, we're redeemed
by your grace. Sins are nailed to that tree. You tore the veil, the earth quaked. By your blood we're set free.
Let's say, church, we're redeemed.
We're redeemed by your grace. Our sins are nailed to that tree. You tore the veil, the earth quaked. By your blood we're set free.
Let's death.
Death is defeated. We rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke us, no more, cause you're alive.
You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our lives. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mind. You are victorious. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our lives. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mind. You are victorious.
We're redeemed by your grace. Our sins are nailed to that tree. You tore the veil, the earth quakes. By your blood we're set free. We're redeemed by your grace. Our sins are nailed to that tree. You tore the veil, the earth quakes. By your blood we're set free.
As death.
Death is defeated, we rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Shackled by your love, bondage that broke us, no more, cause you're alive.
You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our lives. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mind. You are victorious. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our lives. Rock my strong tower, dominion in mind. You are victorious.
Hey. Death is defeated.
Death is defeated. We rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke us is no more, cause you're alive.
Death is defeated.
Death is defeated, we rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high.
not my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious.
Yes, Lord.
You are victorious. We're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our life. Not my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious. You are victorious. You are victorious.
Come on, church, and praise him. Praise him for his victory. We thank you, Lord, and we bless you. And we know, Abba Father, that the victory is yours. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, who conquered death once and for all. You reign on high, O Lord. You reign on high. We lift your name above all names, and we declare that you would be seated enthroned on the praises of your children. Amen, church. Let's sing that again. One more time. Let's declare it together. Death is defeated, and it has no hold on you and I. He is defeated. He is defeated, and you live in freedom. Amen. Hallelujah. Here we go.
Death is defeated. We rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke us. No more, 'cause you're alive.
Death is defeated.
Death is defeated. We rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Shackled by your love, the bondage that broke us. It's no more, 'cause you're alive. You are victorious. We're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our life. I rock my strong tower. We're conquerors in Christ. Unshakable power, come reign in our lives. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious. You are victorious. You are victorious. You are victorious.
Come on and praise him, church. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless the name of the Lord Most High. We bless your holy name, O Lord. We bless you for what you've done for us. We bless you that, Father, through every season of our life, we know that you are there. In the victories, in the highest mountains, Father, we know you're there. But in the lowest of valleys, Father God, even in death, Father God, we know that you are there. And that you move on behalf of those who love you to bring good in our lives, oh Father God. And so this morning, Father God, no matter what season we're in, there may be here, some here, Father God, that are experiencing great joy, great breakthrough, great victory. But then there may be others, Father God, that are experiencing great sorrow and great pain. We call upon the God who is more than enough to minister to the hearts of your children. We fix our eyes on you this morning, O Lord. We center our hearts and come in alignment with you, O Lord, as your living temples. And we declare that you would be glorified in this place, that you would be made manifest in this place, and that your love would rain and fall down in this place.
For you are worthy. For you are worthy of all honor. And we praise you. For you. Through it all, you are all
sense the Lord would like to say to us this morning. As a reminder, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will never abandon you. I will not leave you as an orphan. As your Heavenly Father, you need not fear. You need not worry about tomorrow. For I know the plans that I have for you. They are plans for your good. You need not worry about how you will eat or how you will live or how you will survive. For my grace is sufficient for you in this time. In that moment that you feel totally isolated and alone, know that I, the Lord your God, am with you to the end of the ages. Draw near to me. Put your trust in me. Put your hope in me. And I will establish all of your paths and direct your feet. Father, we thank you and we praise you for that word and that reminder this morning. And I pray, Father, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would go across this room, that you would touch every heart that is listening and seeing and experiencing your manifest glory this morning. Father, bring healing, bring restoration, bring a renewing of the Spirit. Father, we come against the spirit of loneliness. We bind the spirit of sadness and we release your joy, oh Father God. For if our God is for us, who can be against? Amen, church? Let's declare that together. The Lord is my light. We sing.
Shall I be afraid? I will wait for you. set our hope on the Word, who is the everlasting God. You are the everlasting.
Again, church.
I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
We thank you, Father, that that's our promise. That no matter what our situation is, no matter what the circumstance is, our hope is that we will see your goodness. Our promise is that we will see your goodness in the land of the living. Our hope and our promise is that you will work all things out for our good, because we love you, we honor you, we surrender to you, we lift you high, we lift you high, for great is your name and greatly to be praised. So we surrender all of these things to you, O Lord. Whatever is on our mind, whatever is heavy on our heart, we cast all of those cares onto you, and we say, Father, we trust you. We trust you with the cares of this life, and we will wait on you to work all of those things out for our good. And it's in Jesus' name we pray all these things, and all of God's children said, amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. God is good. And all the time, and to everybody. Would you give the goodness of your Lord to your neighbor this morning?
Time of worship. Good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Sherry, and I have the privilege of doing this morning's announcements. We want to welcome all the new faces that we see here this morning. I just feel such an overwhelming joy just this morning. I was just bawling in the back there, just his peace and just him overtaking everything. Just had a hard week, a good week, but a hard week. And God is so good. And I've learned to wait. And when I wait, I see the blessings. So I'm just so thank you for that. I'm just so thank you. Thank for him, all that he has done in my life. Okay. Now, luckily it's a short announcement. Oh, thank you. Okay, so our bulletin, first of all, our connections card. This is an area that we just want to get to know you more. You can share your praise requests as well as your prayer requests. We have a team of warriors that take a look at this, and we pray and praise with you in anything that's going on in your life. Today is Family Day, so we welcome our children here today so they can see how we, as the adults, worship and receive God's message. We also want to celebrate today's, the month of September birthdays. If you could stand and we can sing happy birthday to all of those birthdays in September. Wow, lots. Cool. Yay, round of applause for everybody. Well, we'd like to sing happy birthday to you. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear everybody. Happy birthday to you. We have, if you haven't noticed already, our connections table. We have some new items that we have for you to purchase and just share. Christmas is coming. Go ahead and take a look at that. We also have seasonal items that is half off. Please see Aldera or Lani at the end of service. They'll be more than happy to show you those items at a discounted rate. We also have a new, that water bottle. I thought that was pretty cool with our New Hope emblem on it, yeah? Logo. It's really nice. So go ahead and check out our table. Let's see. And our video. That's it.
Oahu has been participating in Foodland's Give Aloha program, and to date has collected over $2,200. You can donate up to $249 for every Maika'i card to the Legacy of Hope campaign. If you haven't donated yet, be sure you do so in the next 3 days, and tell your friends too. They can donate as well and be a part of building the new home for New Hope Central Oahu. Transformation Academy has begun, but it's not too late. If you had meant to sign up and have not, you can still go to newhopecentraloahu.org and check out the class schedule and get plugged in, because you don't want this year to go by without changing. You want to be transformed. Best place to do that? Transformation Academy.
Okay, that was it. Thank you. Okay, now let's go ahead and continue our worship with our tithes and offering. If you are visiting and is new to Haleiwa, our campus here, please feel no obligation to give and take this as a gift to you. If you are a regular member, please give as the Lord leads. Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for giving me the strength to come up here, Lord. It's hard, but I know I'm doing it all for you. Lord, we thank you for this time that we are able to give back to you, Lord, and know that this is
what you have, this is all yours, Father God. And we just want to give back what you give to us, Lord. And we know that it will multiply, Lord, by just giving from our hearts, Lord. Father, we just thank you for each and every person here, Lord. And we just ask you to just bless them. And I just feel just an overwhelming joy in my heart with you, Lord. And I just thank you. And I just give offerings to you that we will build our church, Lord. And we thank you for all that you do for us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'd like to welcome up Pastor Gen.
Hey, thank you, Sherry. Yeah, give her a round of applause. You know, I was actually thinking of the Ablau family. I don't know why. They just kind of came to me yesterday because Giselle sings for her choral group at Mililani High School. And so we took a trip over to Sacred Hearts Academy yesterday. So I was kind of thinking about Alyssa. So how is Alyssa doing, Sherry? She's doing great. Well, that's great to hear. She's off at college. And of course, we wish her the best. Our heart is always with her. And so I was kind of wondering, you know, how the family is doing and missing her and everything. And so it's good to see Sherry up here by herself, all right? So God's going to make you get up here by yourself one way or another. So it could be you next, okay? But anyway, good morning, everybody. And my name is Pastor Glenn. For those of you that don't know me yet, and I have yet to meet you, so I'm excited to do that. And again, thank you for coming out this morning and worshiping with us this morning as we celebrate on this beautiful, beautiful day. You know, the sun's coming out. It's getting cool. We're getting ready for the winter holidays, and so we're getting ready for, like, you know, Thanksgiving and all these kinds of things. We're making plans already. But where was I going with that? I don't know. I'm just talking story, but it's just we had a wonderful, wonderful weekend. You guys were at the worship concert? Man, God is doing amazing things. Hallelujah. And so, you know, we are just truly humbled, really. As the, you know, I know it's supposed to be a Rosario Ministries, and of course it was spoken over us, and we're just doing our best to be obedient to what the Lord is you know, putting before us, and we're just, like this guy on the screen, just taking one step at a time, amen. But it's just great to go on this journey with all of you as we celebrate the Lordship of Jesus Christ in our lives, and it was just a wonderful night of just celebrating, amen. Celebrating life in Him. And it's great to see a lot of you there. Of course, we had the brothers and sisters from the other campuses as well. So it was just a wonderful, wonderful time. And we just had we look forward to other, you know, concerts or just worship gatherings like that. Not just worship concerts in that setting, but in any setting and opportunity that the Lord will provide. Amen. So as we continue on with Walk Across the Room series. How many of you have ever tried walking across the room and reaching out to the unchurched? Just by a show of hands. Hallelujah. God bless you guys. Yeah, really. You know, it's like I said, like we talked about last week. Ooh, careful, Anna. Like we talked about last week, sometimes we can live in this Christian bubble, can we not? You know, we come and we worship and we just hang out with the same friends. We hang out with the same people. There's nothing wrong with that. But when Jesus says, go, right? Go make disciples of all nations. We kind of freeze up a little bit, right? Because it's safe. It's comfortable. We find encouragement. We find love with one another. And there's nothing wrong with that. But doesn't it make sense to invite other people into what we have and just the richness and the abundance of the life that we have in Jesus? And that's really what the whole series is all about. So in short, it's really about evangelism, is it not? And a lot of us grew up in our Christian life saying, I'm not going to be an evangelist, right? I'm just content being a worship leader. I'm just content being the guy playing guitar on the worship team. I'm just content being a Levite. I'm just content, you know, serving in the kids' ministries. I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, that we are all ambassadors of Christ. And what do ambassadors do in the political arena? They travel from country to country to country to country, right? Representing the government of the United States. But here, as ambassadors of Christ, as we go forth and make disciples of nations, let me remind you again, what makes up nations? People. Hallelujah. So along those lines, we're going to be talking about the power of story. And I want to start off in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. So if you have your Bibles, please follow along with me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. The Apostle Paul speaking, he's writing to the church at Thessalonica. And he says, "You yourselves know, dear brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not a failure. You know how badly we had been treated at Philippi just before we came to you and how much we suffered there." So right off the bat, we see, or we kind of gain knowledge of some of the experiences that Paul is going through, right? Everybody say experiences. Because that leads to our stories, amen? "Before we came to you and how much we suffered there, yet our God gave us the courage to declare His good news to you boldly in spite of great opposition, so you can see we were not preaching with any deceit or impure motives or trickery." In other words, you don't have any of your personal agendas involved, all right? But we do talk about being intentional about going out there, okay? And being ambassadors for Christ. Verse 4, "For we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news," or the gospel, right? "Our purpose is to please God, not people." Everybody say, "Please God, not people." And how many of you know, and how many of you would agree with me that sometimes this is difficult to do, right? Because we want to please our fellow man. We want to look good. We want to smell good. We want to do all this to impress one another, right? But we please God, not people. "He alone examines the motives of our hearts. Never once did we try to win you with flattery," okay? "As you well know, God is our witness that we were not pretending to be your friends just to get your money." Okay, we don't want your money. "As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else." Verse 7. By the way, there's supposed to be a new movie coming out, right? Saul of Tarsus. I'm looking forward to it. And of course, you guys know this actor, Wolverine, Hugh Jackman, right? So it should be good. I'm looking forward to it. Hopefully it's good. But just a wonderful story of Saul and how he went on the road to Damascus. And then he just had, you know, the blinding light. We all know that story. And then bam, right? He converted and became one of the most powerful apostles, right? Wrote the New Testament and everything. So anyway, verse 7, "As apostles of Christ, we certainly had a right to make some demands of you, but instead we were like children among you." In other words, humble, meek, like a little child, right? Apostles, everybody say apostles. Apostles, and you can write this in your margins, everybody. Apostles means the sent ones. So if God is calling you, God is calling us, He's sending you on an apostolic mission, if you will. But the sent ones that you are being called, you're being sent to do the mission of the Lord, okay? "But instead we were like children among you, or we were like a mother feeding and caring for her own children." In other words, compassionate, nurturing. "We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives too." And I will say that again, verse 8. "We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives too." In other words, have compassion
for the unchurched. Have compassion for the people that are outside the walls, okay? Because as our Christian lives, we are to live without walls. We are a church without walls. And you know, every time we come here and we gather every Sunday morning, we see everybody loving on one another, and that is just a beautiful thing. But think of the people that don't know the love of Jesus Christ. Think of the people that don't know the love of God, right? And as we are called to go out there, go out and then say, come. Amen. So you see that dynamic. Go ahead and write in your notes number one. The power of story reveals how my story, everybody say my story, fits into God's greater story. Reveals how my story fits into God's greater story. And together with God, what do? We make history. We make His story, okay? Say again, my story fits into God's greater story, and together with God, we make His story or history. Amen? So you see how that works. So imagine God, an old man, sitting at his desk, clacking away at his typewriter, right? And he's writing love notes to you. And he's giving them to the angels, and he's sending them out, and he's sending them to you. Amen? Right? So God is saying, I love you. And every soul within the sound of my voice matters to God. And I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, that you are a precious child of God, a son or a daughter of God. Amen. And He loves you very much. Amen. So your story matters. Now, there's four areas we must overcome. In other words, you know, four areas we must avoid when we're sharing our story. So we're going to spend time over here a little bit. And I thought this was kind of funny, entertaining, but true. Okay? Now, you know, sometimes when you're out there and you're talking with people and people come up to you and say, well, why do you believe? Right? Why are you a Christian? And I talk with some people and say, you know, you have to kind of develop a script for yourself. Maybe like three talking points or whatever it is. So when people ask you, why do you believe? Why are you a Christian? You know, why aren't you a Buddhist? Why aren't you a Muslim? Why aren't you this? Why aren't you that? You know, I have friends, when I was in South Carolina, I was good friends with a rabbi, a Jewish rabbi, really nice guy. Muslim imam, another nice guy. A Wiccan, you know, another nice guy. You know, of course, we differed in beliefs and all these different things. But, you know, people would ask us, why do you believe what you believe? And for a while, I was stumped. I had to go home. I had to go write it out. I had to go figure it out on my own. I had to figure out where I was going to land. I needed to land on something. Amen. But in order to tell our story to a world, avoid being long-winded. Amen. Because you may lose these people. Remember the three B's. Everybody say the three B's. Be brief, be bold, and be brilliant. Okay? Turn to your neighbor and say, be brief, be bold, and be brilliant. In other words, keep it short, succinct, but be confident in it, right? Believe in it. Trust in it, right? Believe, be strong about it, but also be brilliant. In other words, make an impression on them. Amen. Make an impression. Be brilliant, brilliant like the light that just came down on Saul and then bam, blinded him, right? And he was like, whoa, he couldn't see because the light was just so bright, right? It should be like the gospel, the testimony in your life, when you're testifying, you're like, whoa, what is all this? And then you leave an impression on them, all right? And that's how you want to be. But stick with the story, okay? And we're going to get into that a little bit later. Number two, avoid fuzziness. Avoid fuzziness. Well, what does that mean, Pastor Glenn? You know how sometimes you say this, you say that, like for example, you know, I went to church here, I went to church there, and then I was doing this and I was doing that, and you give them so much, you give them so much information that they can't follow you. You know what I mean? You're like a spiritual ADHD kind of a thing. You're all over the place, right? I mean, you catch what I'm saying, right? It's like, I can't follow your train of thought. You're like, you're talking about baptism, and then you're talking about worship, and then you're talking about children's ark, and you're doing this, you're doing that, right? So avoid fuzziness. Be clear, be direct, be brief, be bold, and be brilliant, right? Number three, avoid religionese. Everybody say Brie. Right? I'm with you, Brie. And what do I mean by that? No, I don't mean to offend anybody. Right? And we can talk like this among circles. Really, because we understand what we're saying. You know, sometimes we're out there and we're like, oh, you know, the Holy Spirit came upon me. And you know, just last night, I heard a funny one. I don't mean to laugh. Okay? But my kids were sharing with me. And what did they say? Liquid love flow onto you. And I thought, well, wow, that's cute. I get it, right? Because Jesus Christ is our living waters. But I never heard it say like, oh, may liquid love flow into you or something like that. Now I'm thinking to myself, okay, I understand that. And in our circles, we understand that as well. But if you go out there into the world and you speak those kinds of things, they're going to look at you like, what? Right? And you may lose some people. I'm glad you can laugh, Diane. But yeah, but you know, it's okay to talk like that when we're together because we understand that. But to the layperson out there, the normal person, the unchurched, you know, they don't understand those kinds of things. So, you know, try not to use religionese too much or Christianese. Okay, because it may be a turnoff. It really may. And I see a lot of heads nodding. Okay? I took a chance on that one. Right? Number four, an air of superiority. Okay, avoid that one too when you're telling your story. You know that holier-than-thou attitude? Right? And I used to have a coworker, and this is maybe about 10 years ago, and she used to attend another church, but we were good friends. We used to work together all the time, and we would talk Christian things and all these kinds of things. But I remember when she would talk with her, like her customers and everything, she would speak Christianese and just kind of bear with me, but she would say, like if a person would come up or a non-believer would come up, she would say, oh, hey, mighty man. Nothing wrong with that, right? Oh, hey, woman of God. Hey, woman of strength. You know, these kinds of things. So I'm looking at her, I'm like, okay. I admired her confidence. I admired her boldness. I did. But then I would look across the desk and I would look at the reaction on some of these people, right? And they'd be like, what are you talking about, right? Mighty man, what are you talking about? I'm a Wiccan. I remember one person said that. And then she would counter back. She would say, well, you may be a Wiccan, but you're still a child of God, right? And so I could see like kind of like heating up already. I could tell it wasn't really a good thing. So then I would kind of intervene a little bit. And I'm not saying that she had an air of superiority about herself, but as a Christian, you know, you're walking around with this boldness because it's Christ who lives in us, the hope of glory. We understand that. So I'm not talking about just a confidence, but she was, I'm a child of God. What about you? Why aren't you a child of God? Kind of an attitude. And so when she did that, it built up more walls than anything, brothers and sisters. Now, I don't mean to criticize. I'm not trying to criticize her, but I observed her for many years. Let's just leave it at that. And what she was trying to do was to reach out to them, okay? She was trying to minister to them. She was trying to witness to them. So, but she batted maybe like, I don't know. She was maybe like 50%, because a lot of the people reached out to her, reached back to her, but a lot of people she kind of put up a wall in between. But anyway, you get what I'm saying, right? Avoid being long-winded. Avoid being fuzzy. Avoid religionese as much as you can. And of course, we are not to be arrogant, okay? But we are to be confident and bold in what we believe in. Amen? Number two, go ahead and write in your notes. The power of story informs everyone the bridge has been built. The bridge has been built. Now, what do I mean by that? When you're out there, again, you know, we're not supposed to avoid, I mean, we're not supposed to create walls in between us and the people we're trying to witness to, but inform everyone that the bridge has been built. Now, what do I mean by that? 1 Thessalonians 2:5 says, "For there is one God and one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity, the man Jesus Christ." Okay? Now, there's different techniques that we can show people, like we have the bridge illustration, we have the morality ladder, we have the Romans road to salvation, and all these different things. I would love to get into that. But I believe Pastor Earl did a class on that. And we can certainly sign up for that if you want, or you can come see me and we can walk you through it. But briefly, I want to talk to you about the bridge illustration. Has anybody seen this before? Yeah. Okay. The bridge illustration. Has four main points. Four main points. Number one is God's love. Okay, and you can turn it around and write on the back side of your paper if you like. But four main points, God's love. On one side, you have man. On the other side, you have God. Now, I'm going to kind of go through this briefly because I want to show you how simple this is. So when you walk across the room to people and you engage in these conversations with people and you have the opportunity by the leading of the Holy Spirit to share the gospel with them, you can share this on a piece of paper, simple piece of paper, a post-it note, a napkin, right? If you're at McDonald's or Starbucks, you can just kind of scribble on the napkin. It's that easy, okay? So God's love, on one side you have man, on the other side you have God. John 10:10, God's love, it says, "For the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus says, I have come to give life and life abundantly." Okay? That is the love of God. And now there's other passages, other scriptures that we can share. But for simplicity, I'm just going to give you one each. Point number two, our problem. Our problem. We have a problem. And that problem, Romans 3:23. We all fall short of the glory of God because of the original sin. Okay, so that is what divides us. We all fall short of the glory of God. And then point number three, God's remedy. God's remedy. Romans 5:8 is a wonderful reference. Romans 5:8 says, Carl, what does it say again? Can somebody shout out Romans 5:8? It just blank, slipped my mind. What was it, Carl? I had it this morning. Romans 5:8. We'll look it up for you. It's the Romans road. God demonstrates his own love for us. Right, Christ died for while we were still sinners. Yeah. Thank you. Danny, is that Danny? Give Danny a hand. Thanks, Danny. Christ died for us while we are still sinners. Okay. Number four, point number four, our response. our response. And of course, John 3:16 is a wonderful one to share, which says, of the world that God gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Okay? So after you explain all this, all right, and then you turn it around to the person you're talking to and say, where do you see yourself in this diagram? Do you see yourself on this side of the cliff or that side of the cliff? And would you like to get to this side? You know, you can kind of lead them with all different kinds of questions, okay? But I wanted to show you this too. Right here we have a blank screen. And I wanted to show you again how simple it is, what we just did. So if you want, follow along with me, use the back side of your paper, and if you have a pen or a pencil, something to write with, you can kind of follow along, okay? And it's going to look like Elmo, Sesame Street kind of a thing, but let's just have fun with it, right? And again, just to show you how simple it is. Huh? Wait. Okay, there we are. I'll use blue. No, I'll use purple. Okay. So on this side, you have a cliff, okay? On this side, you have another cliff. This side is man. This side is God. Now, what divides man and God? Sin. Sin divides man and God. And you can get into the original sin that happened in the Garden of Eden, right? Now, God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. So what you do is you draw a cross, right? And then you can, of course, refer to the passages we just gave you, right? John 3:16. And where do you see yourself? You can ask them, I'm on this side. I want to get over on this side. Okay, so you draw a little stick figure here. And then now, because of the cross, you are now able to make that connection with God. You see that? It's that simple. All right. Thank you for technology. Okay, and you can do that, brothers and sisters. You know, it's... And that's really the story of the gospel in a nutshell. You know, we don't, it's not, don't overthink it. It's really that simple. You know, it's very powerful, of course, but it's really that simple. So you remember last week when we talked about form, family, occupation, recreation, and then the message of the gospel, right? Keep it light, keep it conversational, okay? Now I want you to turn to John 4, John 4, and we're going to see the master at work, Jesus Christ himself, being the example that he is, and evangelizing, and reaching out to an unchurched woman. The very familiar story, the woman at the well, she was a Samaritan woman. Okay, now what is the difference between Samaritans and Jews? Samaritans are Jews, okay, but what is the difference? The difference is throughout all the centuries, we have to remember that the Jews were conquered by so many different other people, like the Philistines, the Canaanites, the Assyrians, and all these different people groups that came and conquered the Jews. The Samaritans were the ones that are believed to have intermingled with these pagan cultures. And that's why, you know, the Jewish people kind of snooty, looking down on the Samaritans, even though the Samaritans are still Jewish. The Samaritans came from the tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh, whereas the Jews came from the tribes of Judah and Benjamin. For all you scholarly types that like to know that kind of stuff, okay? But the Samaritans are Jewish people. So John 4, starting with verse 4, he, this is Jesus, had to go through Samaria on the way. Eventually, he came to the Samaritan village of Sychar near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Verse 6, Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired from the long walk, sat wearily beside the well about noontime. Soon, a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at the time because his disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. Now, keep in mind that this is noontime, okay? And I'll explain the significance of that. But you can go ahead and write in your notes, brothers and sisters. Number one, five lessons of evangelizing. Number one, ask a question. Well, what do you mean, Pastor Glenn? Well, last week we talked about form, right? But ask a question. Notice what Jesus did. Okay, now in a different translation, it's a little bit more obvious. When he says, "Can I have a drink, please?" Okay, "Can I have a drink, please?" And so Jesus asked the question. Now, what was he doing, do you suppose? He wanted to see what kind of reaction he would get from her. Okay? And as the story unfolds, we'll see what kind of reaction she gives him. Okay? But ask a question. That's number one. Verse 9, the woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Jesus replied, "If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask me and I would give you living water." Everybody say living water. "But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket," she said, "and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed?" Okay, so here we see, and we kind of experience the kind of interaction that they're having together. Number two, bridge the chasm. Right? I explained how Jesus is a Jew and the lady is a Samaritan. Clearly, there is a divide between them. Okay, but how did Jesus bridge the chasm? My opinion, very simply, he sat down. He sat with her. You know? He wasn't trying to be domineering. You know, and of course we know that the society back then was a very male-dominated society, so he wasn't trying to, you know, condescend, you know, look down on her. He sat down and he asked for help. Now, clearly, Jesus is he's a construction worker, so he's a strong guy, right? I mean, he could have figured out a way to get the water himself, but he saw it as an opportunity, as a point of connection with this Samaritan woman, okay? So number two, bridge the chasm. Number three, practice patience. Now, why do we have to practice patience? Now, you can see how this lady was somewhat kind of getting confrontational, right? You can see maybe her attitude coming out a little bit. "Why are you talking to me? You're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan. We're not supposed to talk. Aren't you guys supposed to be inside? It's noontime. It's too hot out here. Everybody is supposed to be indoors in the shade. It's too hot. That's why I'm out here," is what she's saying, right? She goes when nobody's there, and that's at high noon. But Jesus, of course, could read her mail. Jesus knew everything about her, and so therefore he was patient with her. Okay, let's move on. Verse 13, Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." Verse 15, "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me the water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water." Now, Jesus, reading her mail, just getting directly to the point, not beating around the bush at all, says, go get your husband. Jesus told her, verse 17, I don't have a husband. The woman replied, Jesus said, you're right. You don't have a husband, for you have had five husbands. Totally reads her mail, right? And you aren't even married to the man you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth. Verse 19, sir, the woman said, you must be a prophet. Now verse 20, this is where it gets interesting. Verse 20, so tell me, why is it that you, Jews, insist that Jerusalem is the only place of worship, while we Samaritans claim it is here at Mount Gerizim, where our ancestors worship? So you see, brothers and sisters, how she completely changed the subject. You guys see that? He wants to address her moral issues, right? Jesus shot straight between the eyes. He wants to address that, her moral failures. He wants to talk about that, but she quickly changed the subject. Maybe she was embarrassed, you know, maybe she was, most likely she was embarrassed. She's frustrated with this guy. You know, he's obviously the prophet. He's reading my mail. I can't hide from him. I got to be transparent. I feel naked in front of this guy. We all hide that feeling, right? When the Holy Spirit is doing a wonderful work in us. But number four, beware of rabbit trails. When you're wanting to share the gospel and maybe that person is not ready to hear what you have to say, you know, they may change the subject on you. But if the Holy Spirit prompts you, keep it on track, okay? Keep it on track. Beware of rabbit trails. Does that make sense? Verse 21, Jesus replied, believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming, indeed, it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. That's Pastor Teresa's favorite line. Worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way, for God is spirit. So those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ, or who is the anointed one. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus told her, I am the Messiah. So number five, give hope to the hopeless. Give hope to the hopeless. Now here we gotta kind of live in balance, brothers and sisters. Remember last week I talked about being wise as serpents, but also being innocent, harmless as doves, okay? Now it's not you who's gonna save them, it's Christ in you who is the hope of glory. We have to be wise as a serpent to understand that. We also have to be gentle as a dove, okay? So we don't come across too brash, too arrogant, too iron-fisted, if you will. We can be strong, we can be bold, right? We can be brilliant, but do not, right? We talked about not hammering their heads with our Bible or shoving the gospel down their throat, okay? But we can be confident in saying that hope, the hope of glory, the Christ in us, the hope of glory. I am the Messiah. Okay, so when I go, I share the gospel, and I can, in effect, say to them, salvation is here, baby. Do you want it? Receive it? Let's talk, okay? But you're giving hope to the hopeless. Check this out. You look at this dog, right? Micah. We look at this dog. And sometimes, the Samaritan woman, I believe, kind of felt this way in a little bit, right? Because how many of you sometimes feel like you're being beaten down by the world? Sometimes you feel spiritually malnourished, right? Maybe you're not feeding on your Bible well, right? You're not feeding yourself, right? Clearly this dog was abused. Terrible, terrible owner. But, you know, as we look at that, and we can kind of maybe see how, you know, maybe the dog is dehydrated. You know, Jesus talked about living waters. Jesus talked about the physical water, and you can drink the water, but, you know, you're going to be thirsty all over again. So it's best to drink from living waters. Well, you'll never be spiritually dehydrated. Can I get an amen? Right? Spiritually malnourished. Feed on the Word of God. Make sure you're doing your disciplines. Make sure you're doing your devos and all these wonderful things that God has for us. But it's our responsibility, right, to feed on the Word ourselves. Now, good news, brothers and sisters, as someone saw this dog, gave them hope, put their arms around the dog, loved on him, and we can imagine Jesus doing that for us, right? And now look at the dog now. Cute, yeah? Chunky dog, cute, right? Squishy dog, cuddly dog, right? Well-fed, well-nourished, well-taken care of, well-loved, right? And so how many of you feel that way ever since coming to Christ? Hallelujah, amen, right? Point number three. Oh, wait, not yet. 2 Corinthians 17 says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. Now, of course, brothers and sisters, you know, my children, who's been in ministry with us for many, many years, they grew up in the church, you know, they grew up in Children's Ark and all these different things, and it wasn't until middle school when I realized that my children actually found joy or found a place for themselves alongside me and mommy, right, in ministry. It wasn't until middle school when that actually occurred. And I remember sitting down with them. I said, okay, kids. And we were just kind of goofing around, having a talk. And I said, kids, if you want to grow up to be a big dog, you got to start running with the big dogs. What do I mean by that? I mean that they had to learn to go from puppy stage in ministry to big dog stage in ministry. So that's the kind of conversations that we have. But in essence, they knew that it was their responsibility, right? And all mommy and I can do is provide an environment for them to want to plug in, an environment for them that will provide an opportunity for them. But it's really up to them to take the next step, to plant themselves, right? Psalm 92:13, my life verse, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Now, how many of you, brothers and sisters, know people out there you care about, loved ones, friends, family, co-workers, that are not flourishing but perishing? Amen? They are not flourishing, but they are perishing. And so it is up to us to go and offer that opportunity for them. Amen? And it's up to them to accept that or not. Now we can pray for them that they will accept the Lord into their hearts, but it's not our responsibilities. Hallelujah. We simply have to make ourselves available for them. So go ahead, write in your notes. The power of story shares who I was before and who I am now. Can I get an amen? The power of story shares who I was before and who I am now. Now, some of you are spiritual chihuahuas. I used to be a spiritual chihuahua. Now, there's nothing wrong with chihuahuas. I know there's a lot of chihuahua lovers in this room. My mom was a Chihuahua lover. I grew up with Chihuahuas. Simply, I'm just talking about the small stature, right, of a Chihuahua. They're wonderful animals, but they're just so small and petite, right? Some of us have to learn to become spiritual Chihuahuas and to spiritual Great Danes, right? Big horse of a dog, right? And that's simply what I'm illustrating, amen? But it shares who I was before and who I am now. Now, we're going to go into a time of communion, but before I do that, brothers and sisters, I want to share four stories of people that actually wrote about who they were before and who they are now. Everybody say that. Who I was before, who I am now. Who I was before, who I am now. Okay, so I want us to think along those lines. Okay, but these are actual people. It says, 4 years, or 4 years, I felt empty. I had a hole I needed to fill. So I searched for things that could fill that hole, a new home, children, new friends, clothes, a new job. My emptiness would be filled for a short time, but never found the it that kept the hole filled. One day I heard about a message about having a relationship with Jesus. Once I understood, accepted, and grew in my relationship with Him, my emptiness was finally filled for good. Today, I am no longer searching for those things to fill my life. Another person wrote in, I used to look for acceptance. I used drugs and alcohol to make me feel like I was somebody. I thought God had put me here as a cruel joke. But then I met Christ. He got me off drugs, off alcohol, and He made me feel worthwhile. I now know what happens is actually like the void in my heart is gone. I now know I have many reasons for being here. One is to share my story to give others hope. My days are no longer miserable. Life actually means something to me now. Isn't that beautiful? Person number three. I was angry and depressed all my life, thinking that the world revolved around me and I wasn't getting my due. I was cynical and isolated. After finding Christ, I felt an amazing love and acceptance for the first time. I began to be liked for who I was by the people around me, and my whole life changed. I came to know the joy of relating authentically with people, opening up with honesty and truthfulness about my life. And the last one. My life was filled with shame and fear. I was all tied up inside and isolated. Loneliness led me to a place of hopelessness. But then I met Jesus. Now I am free from my self-inflicted prison of fear and shame. I am forgiven and loved. I am peaceful about who I am and who God is making me to be. The void inside is now filled with joy. Joy in knowing that I am a precious child of God. Isn't that beautiful? And so this is what I want to throw out to you, brothers and sisters. In your notes, you see that, right? You have that in your notes? And I want to throw this out to you, and I want to encourage you, I want to challenge you to write out your story just like that, okay? Two reasons. Number one, so you know what you're going to share when you have these opportunities to share with people that are unchurched. Make sense? Everybody nodding their heads. And number two, because I want to be niele. I want to know your story, brothers and sisters. Share it with me. Share it with Pastor Teresa. I know some of your stories, but not all of your stories. Everybody has a story, and I will lay my life down and say that it's a beautiful story, okay? Stories of who you were, and then the turning point when you find Christ, Christ comes into your life, and all of a sudden your whole trajectory just changes. Amen. Right off the top of my head, I can say, when my life before Christ was meaningless, it had no purpose, I really had no direction in life. Now I'm speaking from the heart. I really had no direction in life. I was seeking pleasure, doing all kinds of stuff that really didn't have any significant meaning. Right? Attending church, not this kind of church, but attending church, just being religious, you know, thinking I was doing the good thing. And then Jesus came in, somebody told me that I can actually have a relationship with Jesus Christ. What does that mean? And all of a sudden I felt his love. And just like that person that had that empty hole, that empty void in his life, all of a sudden I was just bubbling up and overfilled with joy, and I couldn't understand why. How do you explain these kinds of things? Some of you guys are looking at me like, what are you talking about? I've had that look before, so many people. And I do my best, brothers and sisters, to communicate the love of Jesus Christ. But it's something that you experience, amen? It makes sense in our minds. We can read about it. We can read the word. But I pray the encounter, the Holy Spirit encounter upon your life. Hallelujah. So just by a show of hands, brothers and sisters, who's going to participate in this? Please. Yeah, thank you. Write out your story. I want to know. I want to celebrate with you. And I'll pass it on to Pastor Teresa. She's Niela too. She's all nosy too. But anyway, I want to call up Pastor Teresa. She has a wonderful testimony that she'd like to share that I just found out this morning. And then after that, we're going to go into a time of prayer, communion. So thank you, ushers, for standing by. Yeah.
Check, 1, 2. I'm going to have the ushers come forward and pass out the elements while I'm telling the story, because we want to honor your guys' time. But it's not my story, actually. It's Darcy's story. We heard this morning. Darcy attends our Ohana group because we're going through the Walk Across the Room series. And she comes to church with her auntie and her uncle. And as a fellowship, we were just praying for her because her greatest desire is for her family to know God. And she is a believer because her grandma led her to Christ. So everybody has somebody that walked across the room, right? And so it was really heavy on our heart that we prayed for her family. And so we did. As an Ohana group, we prayed for her family. And more importantly, we prayed that God would use Darcy. Can I get an amen? And so she told me a story that happened just this past week. Her mom was having pain in her elbow and in her ankle. So she went to the doctor, and the doctor told her, there's nothing wrong with you. So she went back home, and her mom was like crying and saying, Darcy, it really hurts, it really hurts. So praise the Lord for faith of innocent children. Darcy, how old are you? 14? She's 14, so there's no excuse for anybody in this room. She's 14. And she ran and she got her Bible. And she started to read to her mom scriptures about healing in the Bible. And her mom fell asleep. While she's reading these scriptures, her mom fell asleep. So she decided, I'm going to pray. So she started praying in the name of Jesus, heal my mom. In the name of Jesus, heal my mom. And then this picture fell off the wall. And above the picture, there was another sign that said, what did it say? I'm sorry. Trust God. Oh, relax. That's the word. Relax. God is in control. So she saw that, and she was encouraged by that, and then the mom woke up, and the pain was gone. Amen. Hallelujah. And it was the courage of a 14-year-old to walk across the room with her Bible, to read scripture, and to have faith that, you know what, God answers prayers. He'll answer my prayer.
and she prayed. And I know that that's just one step of leading her parents to Christ. And next thing you know, they'll be coming here and fellowshipping with the Lord all through their daughter, right? So I just want to encourage each and every one of you. It's not too late to walk across the room. We're praying for more stories like that. And ultimately, all this is possible because of Christ. Amen?
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. So we just want to make it right, brothers and sisters. If you're here this morning and you haven't placed your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I want to make sure that you have an opportunity to do so. Because there is forgiveness, brothers and sisters, for all that we have done in our past. A forgiveness that is available to each and every single one of us. Amen. Now, I'm here to tell you that it's impossible for God to allow sin into heaven. And so when you come to Christ and you believe in your hearts and confess with your mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord, Jesus blots away all your sins and you're a brand new creation once again. Amen. And so if you're here this morning, brothers and sisters, all we need to do is just turn from our ways and turn to Christ. Because I'm here to tell you that heaven is your home. Amen. If that's you this morning, just go ahead and raise your hands. Hallelujah. I'll see you, sister. And maybe you walked away from the Lord. You know, maybe you came to Christ a few years ago. Maybe you made some decisions. And you found yourself drifting away from Jesus, from God. Jesus is calling you back, brothers and sisters. If that's you, just go ahead and raise your hands. I see you, sister. I see you. Let's pray. Repeat after me. Father God, I come before you, and I know that I am a sinner. But I also know that I am made perfect only in you, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. So I turn from my old ways. I am now a new creation in Christ. You live in my heart, Lord Jesus, forever and ever. And I declare and celebrate that heaven is my home. It is in your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. And as we break bread together, brothers and sisters, it was on the night when Jesus was betrayed and he sat around the supper table with his disciples and he said, he passed the bread, he blessed it and he broke it and he said, take, eat, for this is my body that will be broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Brothers and sisters, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in the same way, he took the cup of the new covenant. He passed it around and he said, take, drink, for this is my blood that will be shed for you. To do this in remembrance of me. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We not only remember what you've done, the victory that you have won, but we celebrate. We thank you, Jesus, and we come before you ever so humbly and grateful to you. In your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. And so as a response, brothers and sisters,
I want to sing this song. Sing along with us. No, Lord, you searched me, and you know my way. Even when I fail you, I know you love me. Your holy presence,
your holy presence.
Respond to him this morning.
Surrounding me in every season.
That's it, church.
I know you love me. I know you love me.
Sing it, church.
I bow my knee where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. And you have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now?
Go before me. Hallelujah.
And you go before me, and you shield my way, and your hand upholds me.
Shed for me. There there's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now? You tore the
prayer this morning, and you put all of your faith and all of your hope and all of your trust in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we want to welcome you home to the family of God, for Christ's victory is now yours. Amen. If you made that decision today, would you fill out a communication card and let us know? And there is a free gift for you in the back table. Please make sure you get your free gift if you made that decision. At this time, I want to call all the cakey up. Come on, kids.
Darkness, we're reassured by your love. Believe in Christ our Savior, the risen King victorious. Through the midst of darkness, we're reassured by your love. Believe in Christ our Savior, the risen King victorious. You reign on high, unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke us is no more, cause you're alive. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakeable power, come reign in our lives. My rock, my sure tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Unshakeable power, come reign in my life. I rock my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious.
We sing, we redeem.
We redeem by your grace. Sins are nailed to that tree. So the veil, the earth quakes. By your blood we're set free. We're redeemed by your grace. Our sins are nailed to that tree. You told the veil, the earth quakes. By your blood we're set free. Death is defeated, we rise in freedom. Jesus, you reign on high. Unshackled by your love, the bondage that broke up, no more, cause you're alive. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Shake up the power, come reign in our lives. Rock my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious. You are victorious, we're conquerors in Christ. Shake up a power, come reign in our lives. Rock my strong tower, dominion in mine. You are victorious.
And that's the truth of who you are today. The old has gone, the new has come, and you are victorious in Christ Jesus. Amen. 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 Until we see you next week, aloha and God bless you.